So, welcome to this small session on algorithmic differentiation. Yeah, we still have to finish a few things. So, in algorithmic differentiation, we mainly discuss the backward automatic or backward algorithmic differentiation. So that was the update rule from the chain rule performed backward. We had a very small algorithm implementing this. And in our last session, we made some remarks that we can just do this algorithm on a different level. So we lift it on a different level. Namely, we do it on random variables. And a first improvement when we made this change. So when we considered the variables to be random variables and the operations to perform on random variables on vectors was that we could reduce the memory requirements of the algorithm, yeah, since we just store references to these vectors, and sometimes the vectors can be represented by just a scalar. And then the next thing was that we could also look a little bit closer to operators that were specific to random variables, like expectation operators, conditional expectation operators. And those non-pathwise operators actually made the stuff complicated, because now it was not element by element, the elements got mixed. Yeah? So we had to look at this. And we ended in two small theorems that actually showed us that it's possible to have a small modification to the backward automatic differentiation algorithm that allows us to effectively treat these non-pathwise operators like conditional expectation operators. So an example here for this G is that G is a conditional expectation operator. Yeah, so that was our example. Okay, and if we have that this operator is self-adjoint, then it's possible to just apply this adjoint, yeah, so this operator, to the adjoint derivative while going backward. And then we have that, okay, so the result that we get, so that was in our iteration here, the result that we get is this value di doesn't agree with the matrix dy by dxi, but if we take the expectation, so that is the expectation column wise, yeah, then it agrees with the derivative. And to some extent, this is maybe a little bit a trivial result, because if you have that, if these are here your Monte Carlo passes, yeah, so I draw them as a straight line, and there is an input coming in here, okay, that is calculated to be this output here. And then taking the expectation as a last operator takes the expectation here, and we have a single scalar output. And so if we initialize this value, so let's take this value here as a pink dot. So if we initialize here the derivative of this expectation by one, then we backward propagate a vector. So, and of course, if we backward propagate a vector, everything stays a vector. So to some extent, this theorem looks as if the fact that we use an expectation here below is linked to that we have here we just initialize all elements of the random variables to one. So this means that it's possible to do all calculation in parallel. Yeah. So remember the nice thing with pathwise operators was that we can do everything in parallel because the paths do not mix. And actually, it's possible to prove a small generalization of this theorem. And this generalization, let me flip this two pages here. This generalization looks like this. So if we have some operator G that commutes with the conditional expectation, so here it's now the generalization is that we here only look at conditional expectations for given f's, then it's sufficient to initialize all elements of the random variable to one, perform a backward propagation, and we have that the conditional expectations agree. Okay, if you take the full set omega, yeah, then this is the same as the previous result. But a thing that is a little bit surprising here in this result is that a conditional expectation operator with respect to some sigma field, yeah. So for example, like the one which we drawn in the last session, yeah. So you have this set omega, okay, of elements. And then if you like to have a conditional expectation with respect to a sigma field, and the sigma field is generated by, say, three sets, say these three sets, conditional expectation is just take the expectation on each individual set and assign the value to the elements in this set. Yeah. Okay, then it looks a little bit as if we have a function that has three different outputs. Yeah. And so it looks as if we would have to initialize our backward propagation with 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, then perform the backward propagation and we see what is the derivative. And then we initialize with 0, 0, 0, 1, 1 maybe, and we perform the backward propagation and see what is the derivative. So it means, so conditional expectation is not a single value. It is a function or a vector that has multiple different values. And the question is, why is it still possible to just use a single backward propagation of this vector? Okay, so the surprising fact here is that we initialize the vector with one, yeah, which looks a little bit like as if there was an expectation operator, the last operator, but we get this result also for the conditional expectations. This condition there, well, I have a proof here on the next slide, yeah? So we can go very quickly to this proof, but I can give you a very nice intuition of what is the condition here. If we draw the picture again that we just had. So assume that you have your Monte Carlo passes that generate values. So drawing from left to right, I'm performing calculations. So these here are my input values. So, and the input value is now a random variable on every pass. Yeah, and we are calculating new values and so on. And then in the end, I have an output value, which is also a random variable. And now the partial derivative is what is the change of this value if this value changes? And what is the change of this value if this value changes? So that is the derivative matrix. Yeah. The nice thing with the pathwise operator was that the derivative of this value here with respect to that value is zero. So the derivative is a diagonal matrix. In other words, I can do everything individually, which means I can do everything in parallel at the same time. So the nice thing was that if you look at these lines here, so every line is a Monte Carlo pass, then they do not mix. Okay, so if you have some mixing of the passes, so assume that a value that was used here in the calculation or created here in the calculation enters into something that is performed here on the pass, and maybe a value that is here enters there, and so on. Yeah, maybe a value from here enters there. Yeah, then suddenly you have a dependence across the passes. Yeah? So suddenly this output here depends on that value. And the matrix will no longer, the derivative matrix will no longer be a diagonal matrix. So now the result of the first theorem was that actually the mixing is not such a big problem if the final value is an expectation operator. Because then all those mixings are put together and averaged. And so I only need this condition that I can apply this adjoint operator, which actually does the mixing. Okay, and now the result of this theorem is that if you have conditional expectations, so for example, you have here that I take these three values and take a conditional expectation to become that value, and maybe these two values to become a conditional expectation and that value, and maybe that one is just itself. So I have three sets, so that would correspond to a conditional expectation which looks like this. Yeah. So we have 3 points here which form a set, 2 points here which form a set, and 1 point here that forms a set. So it looks a little bit like that. So or maybe let's take it like that. So, okay. So that would be our three sets. Say F1, F2, F3. And this here is the conditional expectation F1. Then the mixing is allowed as long as we do not cross these sets. Okay. So this is allowed. Okay, so for that one, no mixing is allowed. And it still means that we can do everything in parallel. Okay, so actually a very simple result, but often things are like that the operators that are used in your calculation do mix some passes, but later you are averaging over these passes. So, and be aware that actually this is really a modification of the algorithm that is not transparent if you look at the algorithm on a pass-by-pass basis. Yeah, because if you have a pass-wise algorithm, you do not see that there's a mixing and how the mixing actually relates. Yeah, so actually this is really due to the fact that we perform now everything on random variables. Okay, so I would like to finish maybe very quickly by doing the proof. Yeah, so this here is our full vector. So the random variable, so the output random variable we see, yeah, and this here is now our conditional expectation we perform. And if you have a random variable x, which is ft measurable, and you perform the derivative with respect to some x, which is ft measurable, then actually you have that the output vector is has derivative zero on so if you look at dv star by omega I dv star of omega I by dx of omega j, then derivative is zero. Well, not on every other pass, but if you are on a set that lies outside of this mixing. Yeah, so you have that the derivative of this value with respect to that value is maybe not zero, but clearly you have that the derivative of this value with respect to that input value is zero, because you do not mix the pass across the sets. So we have that this condition here is actually that we have no mixing across the sets. Okay, so that means that actually you can replace the V star by the conditional expectation. So I can replace here the V star by the conditional expectation if I have a conditional expectation on the outside. And since I don't have a mixing, it even means that I can replace this with an unconditional expectation because all the other values do not contribute. They have derivative zero. So I can even place here the unconditional expectation of V star. And the unconditional expectation, we know how to calculate it. We know we can calculate it with a backward propagation using the algorithmic differentiation. Okay, that was maybe for the proof a little bit quick, but I hope that actually this picture here gives you all the intuition why this is a nice theorem. So I'd like to finish now this section and give you a last nice example why it is good to look at random variables. And this example is, okay, that is the implementation. The implementation is very small. I believe we had this in the last session. And this example is an indicator function. So an indicator function occurs very often in mathematical finance. So you have some, say, random variable, say S, your stock, yeah. So or X, yes, we have some random variable X here. And there is some value, say K, and the indicator function gives you zero if you are below K with your X and one above. And if you differentiate now the indicator function, what you get is always zero. So the difference of the two values here, for example, is always zero. Except if you are very close to K, if you do a finite difference, yeah, this minus this is one divided by epsilon is, or two epsilon is one divided by two epsilon, you get a Dirac delta peak. Yeah, so in the limit. So actually it's not so clear since algorithmic differentiation is analytic differentiation, what should we do in this case and how it can be done? And also if we have expectation on the outside, then we can massively improve this. So what I like to consider is the following. I have an expectation on the outside, and I like to differentiate an indicator function that is inside the expectation. And I would like to differentiate that with respect to some parameter theta, and the X depends on theta. And A is just, think of it as a constant that gives you the size of the jump. Yeah, so the jump doesn't need to be one. So if you formally differentiate this, well, then I can interchange expectation and differentiation. And I get here the differentiation of the indicator function and multiplied with the inner derivative, which is how does X move if theta moves. So this here is the size of the jump. This is the size of the jump. And this is the velocity of the jump location. Of jump location. And this here is now our Dirac delta peak. Okay, so that would be if we do the differentiation just formally. Yeah, if you do this by a finite difference, so classic finite difference applied on the outside, I evaluate with theta plus h and I evaluate with theta minus h, take the difference and divide by 2h. Okay, then I approximate the thing by this expression here. Yeah, so expectation of indicator of x of theta plus h, so I assume the x depends on the theta, and expectation of indicator or at x minus h divided by 2h. So it's a centered finite difference. Okay, so that means I can move the 1 divided by 2h inside. That means I do a finite difference approximation of this part here. So now it is that I apply the finite difference here to theta. So I can give me another 1 divided by x of theta plus h minus x of theta minus h and multiply with it again. Yeah. So I just add this term here to the expression. And then you see that actually this part here is a finite difference of the indicator function applied to x. Yeah. So x changed up minus x changed down divided by the up change of x minus the down change of x. And this here is actually a finite difference approximation of how does x change if h change. So this part here corresponds to a finite difference approximation of the indicator function differentiated with x. And this part here corresponds to a finite difference approximation of how does x change if theta change. So you see that if we apply a finite difference on the outside, actually we apply a finite difference to everything that depends on x. So this is maybe a disadvantage of the finite difference, because you know that for the indicator function, maybe you should use a larger finite difference, yeah, because you have otherwise very few Monte Carlo sample passes in the interval. Yeah? So we had a session in the last lecture on this, yeah. So, but just keep it as a rule that here maybe you should use a larger h. But for the finite difference approximation in general, for other function, you should maybe use a smaller value of the finite difference, because otherwise you get non-linearities, non-linear order terms. So we have some disadvantage. So that is here this remark. Yeah. So remark, the finite difference has a disadvantage. So we should use very small shifts for the indicator, and we should maybe use very large shifts or larger shifts. For the indicator, we should use we should not use small shifts. Yeah, but if you use large shifts, this introduces a bias. Yeah? Okay, so it's that way around. Yeah, but you see that our formal expression was that we have expectation of A d indicator dx, our Dirac delta dx d theta, and our algorithmic differentiation performs, if it can, differentiation analytically. So why not just use, if we have algorithmic differentiation, a finite difference approximation for the indicator, and keep all the rest as being differentiated analytically. So this means the algorithmic differentiation applied to the indicator function does the following. So we approximate the indicator function by something which in mathematical finance is sometimes called a call spread. So we go minus h here, plus h here. So it should be zero here, and it should be one here. And in between, we approximate with something which has slope 1 divided by 2h. Yeah? So, and if this is your approximation for the indicator function, then if you differentiate this approximation, you will get an approximation of the Dirac delta, which looks like that. So I have something like that. And the integral of this is just 1. Yeah? So the size is 2h and the height is 1 divided by 2h. So A very first and small way to treat indicator function in algorithmic differentiation is to just approximate the differential of the indicator function by this guy here. So you see this in the code. Yeah, if you look in the code for the random variable differentiable, where we calculate the partial derivatives. Okay, so where is this? Maybe I have to search a little bit. The indicator function's name is choose. Okay, so here is choose. And here I implemented several options to approximate the partial derivative of the indicator function. And one option is here called discrete delta. Yeah, and actually it is, this here is the size of the jump. Y minus z, so I can choose either value y or z, so y minus z. And then I multiply this with this indicator, which is 1 divided by 2 epsilon, and then a jump that has the size 2 epsilon. So it is, actually here it's 1 divided by epsilon, and it's epsilon half to the left and epsilon half to the right. Yeah, so it has size epsilon and it's 1 divided by epsilon. Okay, so maybe you can look at this. It's just 3 lines and it calculates this thing. We can make some more improvements. So first improvements is that we only use the finite difference for the indicator, and we don't use it for the rest of the code. That can have some, it can also be a disadvantage because it makes some things sometimes inconsistent. But this is actually an improvement with respect to numerical accuracy. And we can have another improvement. Actually, there's the question, what is a good shift size H? Yeah. So we like to have some passes inside the interval. So maybe we should adopt the choice of H, whether we are in a region where we have many Monte Carlo passes or few Monte Carlo passes, or maybe we should adopt the choice of H to other quantities like the standard deviation of X. Yeah? And so you see that here in this code, it's possible to actually define this epsilon in terms of the standard deviation of X. So actually, we don't use a fixed X one size fits all. We can adopt it. So this is another advantage. But we can do even better, because since we have an expectation operator on the outside, so we are differentiating expectations. Actually, we know the analytic solution of the expectation of the derivative of the Dirac delta. Well, you know that the expectation of the derivative of the Dirac delta is just the probability density. Yeah. So if you have the integral phi of x dx, and here you have a Dirac delta, then you know that this is just the probability density phi of 0. So actually, I know the integral of this guy analytically. It is the probability density. And what is the remaining part? The remaining part is just a multiplicative constant. Well, it's not a constant, but since we only take the values where x is 0, it is the conditional expectation. Yeah. So all this stuff here, the expectation of Dirac delta multiplied with some other stuff, is the conditional expectation. And now this opens a possibility to make actually a far more better approximation for the derivative of a discontinuous function, if you know that you have an expectation on the outside. We just approximate it by the density multiplied with a conditional expectation operator. Okay, the density can easily be approximated with a regression. So let me go through this a little bit quickly. So we just count how many points do we have in a specific interval. I just count how many points do I have in an interval. This function is then a function d tilde x. And if I shrink the interval, becoming smaller and smaller, dividing by the interval size, so the slope of this function is the density. So actually this looks like this. So you see that if you do the counting here on a very small interval, you have noise. But if you do the interval larger, you have a bias, a nonlinear bias. But if you perform a linear regression, you maybe get a very accurate value for the density. So we can have a very accurate estimation for the density. And so this means to conclude, so this is how the nonlinear regression looks in matrix notation written down. We add an approximation of the conditional expectation. We know how to do conditional expectation. And then in our implementation, we just implement a very small code modification that replaces the derivative of the indicator function with a conditional expectation. So this is this part here. And the estimate for the density. So I have here some switch, yeah, that chooses how the Dirac delta should be approximated. This is the naive discrete delta. And then you have two regression methods here. You can do regression on the density or distribution. And if you search for this term, actually it modifies how the partial derivative is calculated. And he performs some linear regression. Yeah, so you see there is here a linear regression that calculates the density. Okay, and you can here experiment with this different basis functions for this density. Yeah, so say linear and squared, or linear squared and cubic, yeah, and get different approximations for this. So very short implementation, and this is what you get as a result. If you do normal classical algorithmic differentiation with just the discrete delta, yeah, then you get very noisy result. Yeah. So this is due to the shift size being small, yeah, because for small you get very noisy result. So this here is the error distribution. Yeah, these are errors. Okay, so I get very noisy result. So the true analytic result, yeah, is here. This is the true analytic result. This is the true result. Okay, so if I'm further away from this, yeah, it's bad. And if you use this estimation of the density, then this noise by the regression is removed and I get this blue line, which is much better, less noisy result. And those who have seen the session in the other lecture on likelihood ratio method, they know that the likelihood ratio method is a very good method for discontinuous functions, but we know to use some analytic formulas, so it's not so general. So this is still a little bit better, but you already see that this trick here with we estimate the density directly is almost as good as the likelihood ratio method. Yeah, that were two nice examples. What you can do if you do algorithmic differentiation on a lifted level for random variables, so you have some more possibilities to actually improve the differentiation operator for specific problems. Yeah, that was it for this small session on algorithmic differentiation. Yeah, so today only half a lecture. And that also now concludes our sessions on algorithmic differentiations. I have a few more small topics on algorithmic differentiation, which I can cover maybe in different sessions, but now we have a break from this. Okay, thanks.